This is Jedi General Pong Krell. I welcome you to the Voice of the Republic podcast. Listen to this podcast. That is an order.
Your reputation precedes you, General. The reputation of a great new podcast.
Hello, Star Wars fans across the galaxy. Welcome to the Voice of the Republic podcast. My name is Daniel, and joining me is fellow host Ruari Williamson.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
So,
just say my YouTube name.
So, obviously, this is our first episode. Big thing. And we've got some lovely guests with us today. Will you mind telling us who they are, Ryan?
We have Texcomplex from YouTube, and also joining us is Dave Fennoy, voice of General Pong Krell from the Embarrassed Arc of the Clone Wars Season 4. So, how are you both doing?
Good.
And so is General Pong Krell. I'm happy to be here.
So, Daniel, take it away.
So, this is obviously great to have Dave Fennoy in our first podcast, obviously. And we're hoping to possibly discuss the Embarrassed Arc a bit, just while Dave's here, his opinions, and also ask him some questions that we have and read some answers from some Facebook followers that happily asked us to ask some questions. So, yeah, so first of all, what's your thoughts on the Embarrassed Arc, Dave?
Wow, well, we're going back to episode 4. I thought it was great. I really enjoyed playing Pong Krell. I like being the bad guy. I also like being the bad guy that you don't know is the bad guy till you figure out he's the bad guy.
You just answered my question.
What's that?
You just answered my question.
Oh, I'm sorry. Am I answering too many questions at once? I thought it was a great arc. I am a Star Wars fan, not nearly the fan you guys are, and probably not nearly the fan most of your pod listeners are. However, I definitely get into the characters I play, and this was one badass, four-armed Jedi who goes wrong. My only regret is that he gets killed at the end.
Well, that's actually a lot of people's regrets. People would have liked to see him last a bit longer, see what he did, but oh well.
Well, my only hope is that they go back further and and bring him back before he was killed, and maybe when he was a good guy. Maybe we find out what turned him. That would be
just
cool.
Just imagine though, like if they had let him survive or something, like going into season 5 before those different villains out there, you'd have Maul and Savage and Krell and all. You know, there'd be so many villains out there that would be like, don't really know how to put this mildly, but it'd be hell for a Jedi trying to do force. And it would have been like very interesting if Krell had become Dooku's sort of.
But basically, you're saying that we had to kill him off. There would have been too many bad guys. They could have killed somebody else. Let me live.
Yeah, but they could. They might not have needed to bring Maul back if they let. Or we could have just not brought Maul into the series at all.
Yeah. Well.
Well,
that wasn't gonna
obviously
happen.
There's one of our friends, Dan Grievous, who totally disagrees with the Embarrassed Arc.
What doesn't he like about it?
He just thinks the 501st. That's basically it.
He hates the 501st and clones, but he really liked Carnage of Krell. Like, that's the only episode that he likes.
He just despites the 501st, he thinks they get too much storyline in the Clone Wars.
You think they get
too
much attention?
To each his own?
To each his own. I mean, sometimes, I mean, Rari can tell you this, sometimes me and him will discuss for hours about Umbara, him agreeing and me disagreeing.
Oh, hours upon hours, it just never ends.
It must have been going on, it must be going on for months now. Since Umbara.
With me and him, like, the whole debate said ever since the first episode.
He just has something to find about Umbara that's wrong in the 501st.
I always thought on the Umbara trilogy could have been interesting if Ahsoka was with Anakin. And then when he was told to come back, Ahsoka was there as well. So then she could have, like, questioned why Krell treated the clones like that.
But you know what would have been very interesting, actually, but this is just my opinion. If, like, Ahsoka had to be involved in the whole thing too, like, Ahsoka was momentarily reassigned to Krell. Now that would have been weird.
That would be weird. Like, Rex and Ahsoka assigned to Krell.
But if you actually think of it, they have done, like, strange reassignments like that before. Like, in one Star Wars comic, like, Obi-Wan was believed dead at one point, so Anakin was temporarily reassigned to Kiadi.
That's true, yeah.
Yeah, but they only thought he was dead. He wasn't really dead. You see me get...
He is dead.
In mid, I didn't even get to finish my line.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Oh.
So should we get on with the questions?
Sure.
Yeah, so I'll just jump in first and ask you, how much did you enjoy playing General Pong Krell in the Clone Wars?
You know, it is one of the one of my favorite characters to play. As I mentioned before. The bad guys are always the most fun to play.
Yeah.
And especially when it's a bad guy that you don't know is a bad guy.
Yeah.
Or with Pong Krell, because he was such a hard ass, you know, you think he's a good guy, but you think, okay, well, he's, you know, he's kind of stiff and demanding. But he is the four-armed Jedi, so we're going to go with it. And then you find out, oh, no, he's a traitor. I knew there was a reason I didn't like him.
A fire in his eyes.
What's that?
I pretty much tricked he was evil the second he saw the bit where he had fire in his eyes.
Oh, yeah.
He was an interesting character to see in the Clone Wars.
Absolutely. And once again, what I'd like to see, and this is purely selfish, I'd like to see them do episodes previous where you get to meet Pong Krell and find out what happened to him to make him the person that he was, the four-armed Jedi that he was, and how was he turned? What made him turn?
Well,
that would be a great episode.
Yeah, my only real disappointment with the Umbara arc was, like, we didn't really see enough of Krell, and I think, like, we should have seen him in an arc previous to Umbara or something like that, because, like, we didn't really get enough of him in action.
Yeah.
Like, half of the last episode was him in action. We had a bit of Krell action, like a tiny bit, kind of.
Mm-hmm.
In some people's eyes, it doesn't really count in Darkness and Umbara, so it wasn't really that much Krell action after being hyped up in the trailer.
Well, you know what? I agree with you, and at the same time, you don't know what's going to happen in the world of Star Wars.
I mean, we've got season 5 and season 6 ahead of us.
See, you know, well, we don't know. Well, I can tell you he's not in season 5.
Season 5.
I would have recorded that already. But I wouldn't be surprised if somebody were listening to conversations like this and looking at the emails and tweets and Facebook messages from other Star Wars fans that really like Pong Krell and would like to know, well, how did he go from where we met him? Who was he before that, and why did he become the person he became, or the traitor that he became? So it could happen. It could happen.
Anything could happen.
Dig it.
Yeah, it'd be quite interesting to see, like, the honesty about the Jedi and what he's thinking, because what he says is actually true. But how he's saying that he wasn't naive and no longer naive enough to be a Jedi.
Yeah.
So it'd be quite interesting to see what he actually thought.
Yeah.
Actually being able to find out what he's fully thinking about it.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
And also, my second question was he an easy character to roleplay?
You know, for me, he was. I pretty much knew who he was when I read the script. You know, sometimes you just get a feel for a character. Vocally, he is right in my wheelhouse. And frankly, I kind of channeled a little of Darth Vader. Because I kind of feel like, well, this was like a Darth Vader-like character that didn't get to live as long and do as much dirt as Darth did. But were he given the opportunity, he'd be the same kind of character.
Yeah. Well, yeah, it's true. I mean, it's interesting. So, you got any questions for him, Rari?
Yeah.
Me?
I just for one, speaking for my collector side, Dave, would you buy a Hasbro General Krell action figure?
I would, definitely. And I would encourage everyone to buy one.
I would
love to have that sitting on my shelf.
We're all waiting for one. It's just if Hasbro actually get their fingers off the desk and actually do one.
Well, my question would be, if I were Hasbro, the question I would have was, well, we had this Pong Krell character in season 4. How popular is he? How many are we going to sell? Those are the kind of questions they're going to be asking themselves.
Everybody loves Krell.
Aside from those little kiddies, but I don't really wander around too much.
Everyone loves to hate Krell.
Yeah, it's a love-hate relationship.
It's a love-hate relationship. Oh, we love that bad guy. Kill him.
No, I didn't want him to die. I hate Dogma because of that.
Yeah, well, you and me both.
And what about you, Tex? Have you got any questions for him?
Well, he already answered my question.
Oh, that's true, actually.
Well, his thoughts about playing someone who's going to be double-crossing someone. They'll be double-crossing, like, the entire... Actually, I got the question now. What are your thoughts about when you had when your character got all the clones to kill each other?
Say that again.
When you got all the clones to kill each other.
Yeah, I found
that.
I found that
successful.
I found that interesting that he managed to get the clones to think they were in barons and kill each other.
They were clones. What do they know?
It took a bit of time for Rex to actually realize.
He's Rex, what do you expect?
And you still...
silly clones. Still... Just follow orders. Now. Do as you're told.
I'm telling you, Dan Grievous is going to really enjoy listening to this.
You aren't being paid to think. As a matter of fact, you aren't being paid at all. You're paid to die.
Actually, in terms of playing character who start off you think he's good. In my friend's video he's doing, I'm playing an AI called Fury, who starts off good and then eventually sort of goes kind of power hungry and gets deactivated, but then sort of comes back and takes control of all these security droids, and I end up getting my own army. It's pretty awesome.
Hey, it's
sort of
it happens.
It's good, but then I sort of get power crazy, get killed, and then come back. The body.
So I think we've got some Facebook questions for you, Dave.
Okay.
You want to read them out, Rami, or do you want me to?
I'll read them out. Dave, first from Daniel Joyter. He asks you two questions. I'll just read them separately if you don't mind. First of all, which was the most fun Krell moment for you, the voice?
Which is the most fun moment doing Krell?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. I think when I reveal myself...
it's treason, then.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was definitely a great scene. And he also asks you something completely not Star Wars related.
Completely off the chain.
Yeah. Yeah, but anyway, Dave, he asks, as the voice of Lee Everett, have I said that name right? Which is your favorite episode of The Walking Dead video game?
Oh, wow. Well, you know, each one has gotten better. So right now, number three, which is the one that is out, is my favorite. And, you know, I know you Star Wars people have no interest
actually,
in The Walking
I'm
Dead.
I'm
going to
catch you there. I'm a Walking Dead fan as well.
Oh, good. Good. But it's one of the best. It's one of the best characters I've ever played. It's a lot closer to voice wise who I am. And generally, you don't get as much just in depth acting in games as I got in this. So it's it at this point game wise, it's my favorite game that I've ever done.
Yeah, it's good. The Walking Dead is definitely on my list of things to, like, get into.
What other games have you voiced in?
Oh, boy. Well, let's see. I'm five characters in Dota, D-O-T-A. I'm in Worlds of Warcraft, Worlds of Starcraft, Metal Gear.
Wow.
Ultimate Spider-Man, Star Wars, which one? I'm in a couple of Star Wars, the Pod Racer game. I play Lando Calrissian in one of the Star Wars game. I'm Tomb Raider. I'm in like 50 different games.
Wow. That's...
No. Curse of Monkey Island. just the list goes on and on.
You could be here all night, but unfortunately, haven't got.
Yeah, I'll be an upcoming character in Skyrim, in their next release. And also, I should tell you about a very cool project. It's called Anomaly. It will be the world's biggest graphic novel, and it has interactive pages. You get a an iPhone or iPad app, probably Android as well, and you look at the pages through your iPad or Android or iPhone, and they come to life, and you see the action and hear the characters. I play a couple of the characters in that, and it's going to be just amazing.
That sounds actually quite cool.
Yeah, it's so cool. It's such cool technology. I can't wait, and it's gonna drop in November.
Oh, keep an eye out for that then.
Just in time for Christmas.
Yes. So we also have some more. We also have some more questions for you.
Okay.
And Callum says, "What did it feel like to play such a highly anticipated character, and now such an amazing character among fans?"
Which character is he talking
about? Krell. Yeah. I presume.
Well, you know, this sounds a little odd. On one hand, it's just another day at the office. On the other hand, it's Star Wars. And anytime you're doing anything in perhaps the biggest franchise in the world, it's a big deal.
Yeah. And then next question is from Abraham, and he says, "What is it like doing a Clone Wars voice recording, and will we see you voicing more characters in the future?"
You will definitely see me or hear me voicing more characters in the future, because that's what I do. So I have no intention of quitting doing that. I think sell insurance now. No, that's not going to happen. And what was the first part of that question?
What was it like?
What was it like doing a Clone Wars voice recording?
Oh, it was great. And one, not just because it was Star Wars and clones, but I got to work with Dee Baker, who's one of my favorite voiceover actors, and he's just so talented, and having him right there and doing scenes with him was just a gas.
And, your character was quite anticipated, and like a lot of people in the comments on the videos were like, is that a bad guy, is that a good guy? No one could tell. Because people thought he was a good guy, and he started like... I think it was
He seems like he's a good guy, but just very officious and by the book. Which is how we wanted to play him. We didn't want to tip our hand that he was a traitor. Just, you know, a by-the-book kind of guy. And I love that I was able to play Pong Krell. And like I say, I'm hoping they'll bring him back from the dead.
My brother could not work out which one. My brother would sometimes call Krell the shark. He wouldn't know which one it was. And then eventually we just settled on he calls Krell the frog.
He does look a little froggy, doesn't he?
He's a big, like, shit.
We have to tell him frogs don't have forearms.
Or lightsabers.
Definitely not lightsabers. I've never seen a frog with a lightsaber.
That could be terribly wrong.
Someone needs to take that to Photoshop.
And, you know, that would be a great way to, though, get your flies, though, instead of having to get them with your tongue.
If anybody in this podcast is listening, comes up with the idea, post it on our wall.
There you go. We want to see that photoshopped. Forearm frog with lightsabers. Ribbit.
Yeah, just to clear up now, I'm not like, I don't think I'm going to be on the podcast again. I just wanted to be here because I'm a massive Krell fan.
Oh yeah, we did have another host which unfortunately couldn't make it, and we thought we'll give Tex the chance because he's a big Krell fan.
Yeah.
But he couldn't make it. We'll tell him Pong Krell is angry. And he will
actually
have to
the next
pay.
Question comes from the guy that couldn't make it.
Yeah, Tom Wintmolder said, did you have any interest in the character before you had to voice him?
You know, I have to admit, no. I knew nothing about Pong Krell before I got the sides and did the audition. They didn't just call me. I had to audition. And I was happy to have got that.
Oh. Yeah. So, unfortunately, that's...
Yeah, they just hold a picture up in front of you and just say, do you want to voice this for a frog?
Unfortunately.
What's that?
What was that text?
They just hold a picture up in front of you and just say, do you want to voice this for a frog?
Yeah, exactly. Well, and actually, that's what they do. They send you, you get some dialogue. And now I didn't know when I got the dialogue that this guy was gonna Pong Krell was gonna turn out to be a traitor. All I knew that was that he was a four-armed Jedi, and was very officious. And that's all I got. And I created the voice from that, and they liked it. Ta-da!
Well, unfortunately, that's all the questions that were asked. I'm sure. People didn't realize, if not, we would have probably had a few more, but these people be happy at least Krell answered their questions.
Well, you know what? I'm happy that you guys were interested to ask me to come on your podcast. And, you guys send me emails and keep in touch and whatnot, and I am honored. I truly am.
When Ruari told me,
happy to do it, and if I can do stuff for you, let me know.
When Ruari told me that you were coming on the show, I can actually believe it.
He actually didn't believe me.
I just told him, very funny, now who's actually coming on.
I'm going to tell you, I love doing this stuff. I truly do. It's a pleasure, and don't let any of your voice actor friends kid you. We love that the fans love what we do and the shows that we're in and have an interest in talking to us about it.
Oh, yeah.
It means the world to us. It truly does.
I'm actually a voice actor at the moment, but not for, like, proper TV shows.
You're being a voice actor?
So what I said earlier about the AI... I'm like voice acting him as well.
Ah, good.
It's like for Halo. Good.
Ah, good game.
It should be interesting.
Well, gents, I guess I'll pop off and thank you so much again. I'm sure.
Honor having you on the show.
Be talking and you know, keep in touch on Facebook and all the best.
It's an honor having you on the show as well. Yeah, so.
Thank you, thank you. All right.
See you.
Welcome.
Bye. Bye-bye.
Well, that was actually quite exciting to have Krell on the show.
Yeah, that
well,
was awesome.
Seeing as the rest is about figures, this isn't really my dominion, so I'll probably be leaving as well.
Are you going to be leaving?
Because I've collected no Star Wars figures at all, so this is not really my domain to be talking about.
Yeah.
Well,
it's your cortex. If you want to leave, I'm not going to stop you.
Otherwise, I'm just wasting my time. But I'm just going to say, seeing as this is about trailers, I think Ventress is after Ahsoka because Palpatine's placed a false bounty on Ahsoka's head to try and get her killed to mechanic and go evil.
Well,
bam, yeah. That's my living note.
Well, it was...
Well, I don't know about you, Daniel, but that with Dave Fennoy was just awesome. I can't wait to get more Star Wars cast on the...
No, that was...
10-10-10.
That was just awesome, yeah. Well, I guess we should continue with the show.
Yeah, even though there's only two of us
now,
we can't exactly stop
now. We can do it. I mean, it's you and me.
Well, we've got the amazing and the not-so-amazing, and we both know what we're going
to So, obviously, our next subject is the vintage collection line. Obviously, is coming into its last year before they take a break, isn't that right?
Yeah, it's not gone for good. It's just taking a one-year break at least, maybe two, but definitely a break in progress.
In other words,
which isn't honestly a bad move because you know they need to keep the lines fresh and all. But even though I mean the vintage collection is easily one of Hasbro's best Star Wars lines of all time. I mean. They have to give it a break, because, I mean, over 100 figures, 115, if I'm not mistaken, is definitely a lot.
Yeah. And what's your favourite vintage collection figure?
Well, I'd have to go with Sofa, the figures I don't have yet, which is Malgus, Starkiller, and figures like that. Bespin Leia, which I'm looking forward to getting to, but... Have the like 20 or so ones I have right now, I definitely go a vintage collection of Darth Maul. Because it's easily the best Darth Maul figure yet. But probably what a few good ones that has ever done. And I've had real problems with perfecting Maul over the years. The vintage collection phase is just winning.
Yeah.
So, what's your favorite figure then?
Mine's Malgus, and I've rarely actually gone for Oddball as well. Which
you have both.
I don't have any of them actually. I've gone for two figures that I don't even have. Which obviously it's something that I would do.
You should be ashamed, Mr. Schofield.
Am I always?
Yeah, you probably always are. That's why you need me.
So obviously we have some Facebook comments from people that left. We got a lot of comments. We couldn't pick all of them.
So we picked the best ones. No, and for those who didn't say the best ones.
Do you want to read it?
Yes, I am that, me.
Do you want to read out the first one?
Yeah, anyway, Daniel George, yes, him again.
No.
Don't know why he's always here. Anyway, Dan says, even if I love vintage Grievous, he is said to be just a repaint of a legacy collection Grievous. So I will go with the best figure in the vintage line so far, Dante Define.
That's a weird figure to pick out, sorry to interrupt.
It's a really good one. What a better one to
I mean, yeah, it's a good separatist.
I have to correct you on your mistake there. He died before the Separatists came.
Well, yeah, he's the Confederacy then. Sorry about that.
technically he's a trade federation. Let's not go into the debate.
I'll just continue.
Yeah, anyway, you just don't want me kicking your butt in this.
No.
Anyway, this figure is most detailed and the best painted of all I have seen, and there's great articulation for a robed character, even if I do not care for articulation. If next year Hasbro releases a Separatus from the Tekka clones, I hope it is what time more done in the same exact style as Divine. All Attack the Clones and Revenge of the Sith Separatists to need updated figures.
I suppose he's got a point there.
Yeah, but he's kind of contradicting himself a bit at the end line. He's like, all Attack the Clones and Revenge of the Sith Separatists to need updated figures. Yeah, he's always going on about how he doesn't care for articulation.
That's true.
That would definitely be updated figures. Like, detail-wise, most of them are fine, except for Pasella Gente. Who has two figures, and yet neither of them even look like the character, not quite their colour. But the rest are kind of fine, in my opinion, as far as detail goes. Yeah. Dan, my friend, I'm sorry, but you're kind of contradicting yourself here.
Dan, stop contradicting yourself. So, we also...
Dan, we still love you, don't worry. Only nothing. And Anakin's Angel says, Ayla Sakura. In my opinion, this is the most detailed, accurate figure of the line, looking just like Amy Allen, the actress who she played in the movie.
Wow, did he actually put he played in the movie? Played he?
Yeah, Anakin's Angel said the actress who played he in the movie.
Anakin, we need to get your spelling right.
Daniel, you can't really talk much. Your punctuation and grammar is awful.
We're in a Star Wars podcast, not Grammy Nazis, grammar Nazis.
Oh, come on, this is fun. Okay. Also, it has flawless articulation and is one of the best articulated Star Wars figures in general. But I have to say about Anakin's Angel comment, aside from that terrible blooper, I would definitely agree with Anakin's Angel. Is also one of my favourite figures, and even made it into my top 10 figures.
I missed out a Yellow Skewer of the Vintage Collection on like the last.
I missed all of the vintage.
No, I actually put a bid on eBay for it, and I missed out her in the last 10 seconds when somebody came in with a bid for like £20 for her.
Oh my god.
I'm just like, I'd put like £5.50, and it went for days without anybody bidding, and then like 10 seconds to go, somebody came in with £20, and I just like, fell off my seat. Like, why did they put that much?
They would have won with £6.50.
Yeah, they would have.
And anyway, Jose Ramirez says, Captain Fordo is one of the bestest toys. His new head sculpt is off the hook.
Fordo
is definitely a cool
clone. I mean, it's intelligent that he's got like the replaceable helmet as well.
That's one of the best parts about the Fordo figure. It's unique in that it comes with both designs. If anything, they're like both like clones like that, realistic clones like Rex, Cody, Bree should both come with phase 1 and phase 2, not just, you know, one or the other.
Yeah.
But Adam Wharton says, I gotta say Revenge of the Sith AT-AT driver, mainly for the face sculpt, LOL, and the Clone Wars Anakin Skywalker. Okay, on the first brother's comment, Revenge of the Sith AT-AT driver, I definitely have to get that one at some point. It's one of the older ones I'm missing. As for Clone Wars Anakin...
Why, Adam?
I just don't want to put into words what I really think, because that would just, like, offend someone, so I'm just going to make noises.
Yeah.
Which I created. To finish off what Adam said, he says, I'd also like to add Death Star Capture Return of the Jedi Luke. Somehow that doesn't sound too right. Is that just me? He's like, Death Star Capture Return of the Jedi Luke. Oh, now what am I thinking? I'm a celebrity. Maybe meant Death Star too. Anyway, he also says how they kept the look almost all almost all of the vintage with their hair and style, yet keep it modern. and it's probably the best suit sculpt out there. I think Hasbro needs to start capturing the essence of the characters rather than going for perfection. Because if they mess one thing up, it looks
poor. Yeah.
And while I was a bit iffy with a couple of his points, I definitely agree with Anka. I mean, Hasbro can do some great figures, but I mean, there's always at times, like, there's an if, and it's a big if.
Yeah, yeah.
Should I say but, which kind of ruins a figure, I mean, well, degrades a figure, but I mean, I'm just getting a random example out of my head. Shay Vissler from Vintage Collection. That figure is phenomenal, but the face sculpt is not.
Yeah.
I mean, Shay Vissler's face sculpt is just terrible.
Yeah.
But I'm just taking a random example.
So, as we all know, the Americans had Star Wars Celebration 6. And next summer, on July the 26th to the 28th, we have Celebration Europe coming. And obviously, it's the second edition, so obviously...
Daniel, can I just say something?
Yeah?
You know what I would love so much? Is if we got to see the first episode of Season 6 of The Clone Wars before the Americans.
Now, if we got to see that, I'd actually laugh at the Americans, and no offense.
I would just die hearing the news. I'd be on the ground laughing. I wouldn't be able to get up all day. Like, no, especially if I got the news in the morning, as I'm supposed to be getting ready for school, I would be able to get up and go to school.
Yeah, yeah, I'd actually get up, like, dancing to college. So obviously, you'll be going. Now I'm still in doubts if I'm going. Hopefully.
Well, to be fair, mate, you can't really say you're definitely going until you're actually standing inside convention.
It's doubtful. I mean, I don't want to go into the whole subject of why you can and why you can't go, but it's just. It can happen or it can. I mean, I'll know by probably January if I'm going or not. But yeah, so obviously that's going to be fun. Obviously we don't know anything about Star Wars Celebration Europe yet.
Yeah, the only thing we kind of know is that Dave Filoni has hinted he may be there. Like, we know nothing for certain.
Yeah. And obviously obviously, at Celebration 6, Hasbro revealed the new waves that will be coming out, and they also revealed Celebration 6 Star Wars The Clone Wars trailer and clips.
Hasbro abomination, the lot of it. The Clone Wars love it.
I remember the day that they announced all the figures, and you were just ranting for the whole afternoon.
I was ranting away. It was blissful.
I felt...
I needed a good rant after not ranting for, like, only a month or so. I needed a good rant, and they gave me the opportunity as they usually
do. I mean, I think I left my Facebook chat open, went to have a shower, had a cup of tea, came back, and they were still ranting.
Yeah, I just don't stop when I stare at that's why I often have to go to the video camera to pass what I'm ranting from the blood.
And obviously we had the Clone Wars Season 5 trailer, which looks... Let's have your opinion first.
Phenomenal. I could go on, but I think you'd get
it. Yeah, we could go on and on and on and on and on.
I mean, there's no real specific scenes I can take out of the trailer and comment on, because the whole thing was just amazing.
And obviously we've seen, like, these few days, and at Celebration we've seen clips coming out, and obviously a clip came out a few days ago of Savage turning on Maul, or Maul turning his...
it's not so much a turning on each other, it's something else.
It's like brother stuff. We'll just leave it to them.
Basically, as Maul says, it's a lesson of sorts. Just leave it at that.
Yeah, I mean, we also had other clips that I can't...
Yeah, but like, I'll just go throw this out there, and it's not really a spoiler to say it that much, because it's so obvious Maul will kick his butt. And yes, I know that Maul does beat Savage in this war. And no, like, this has been a bit of a debate I've noticed, and I have to clarify it. No, Savage does not lose his arm by his own brother.
Yeah.
That happens later in the same episode. Same episode, but not more.
Yeah, I mean, I can't wait for the season 5 to start. I mean,
yeah, it's only 8
the
days.
Americans are ranting away because it's like at 9 o'clock in the morning for them.
9:30 a.m. Like, I'm actually a bit ranting as well, because, I mean, you know, I'm not too bothered about the time change a lot, but I just loved, like, waking up every Saturday morning to a new Cars episode. Like, I'd specifically set the time for, like, 6 a.m., 6:30, maybe even 5:30, depending on the episode. And, like, I'd get up, and it's just waiting for me on some website, and I'd be, like, so happy, wake up to my favorite TV show. Bam, get to watch a new episode, start writing a review immediately. Basically, it was bliss. But now, like, I have to wait till, like, evening for it to get online, and then the review will only be done, like, around midnight or something. So I better take the update that. Like, it kind of, as well, took the time I could spend doing my outside life as well, you know, friends and all. So it does irritate me a bit. Right. I honestly think I have more reason to complain than the Americans, to be honest.
Oh yeah, I mean, the Americans think, oh, it's a big deal, but then it affects other places in the world. I mean, for example, we're going to take him again, Dan Georgiev, it's probably just going to make him angry.
Yeah.
But yeah, obviously, season 5, we can't wait, we want it now.
Just 8 days to go.
8 days to go. The count. We'll do the count. We should do the count then on our Facebook page with like a picture.
Oh, come on. Stop spamming. Don't spam up the page. Don't you dare.
Well, we've got Blogger and Facebook now.
Well, then spam up Blogger for all I
care. As long as it's not Facebook, you'll be happy.
Yeah, pretty much. You can spam on your own stupid profile.
I'll just keep spamming with new covers.
Oh, come on. That's even worse, because like, they go onto the main pair as well. They won't be able to see who we've got next week. Won't be our last questions for that pair.
Well, anything else you'd like to point out, say, discuss before we start shutting this thing?
Yeah. Hasbro sucks. Lego rules. Simply put.
Anything else?
No, do you want me to say it again?
Well, Hasbro sucks and Lego rules. Is that all?
Yeah, pretty much. I think it sums up what I think right now.
Okay then. So will we get this thing finished?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we just need to like look everything now. YouTube channels,
Texas,
and Dave's
website. I'll do this if you want.
Yeah, actually, no, you can, like, do your YouTube. I like doing
it. Yeah, okay. So make sure to check out the YouTube channel. Mine is www.youtube.com/user/14listedass. Text is www.youtube.com.user/textflex. And yours is?
Mine is www.youtube.com/users/yes.
And also, you can check out Dave Fennoy's website, www.davefennoy.com. So, this has been one hell of a first podcast, that's for sure.
Which has also included a bit of cussing within here.
I mean,
we both said hell.
Oh well, it's technically past 9 o'clock here, we can say these words.
Yeah,
so obviously it's been really good. We've had Dave Fennoy, who's just been amazing. We've had Tex. And yeah, so this has been our first.
And we've had you.
And we've had you. This has been our first. This has been our first podcast. We're hoping to come back next week and bring you more news. We'll come back next week if he's coming. And then the one problem is I thought we would be able to speak properly because I'm making voices. Yeah, so. So may the force be with you, Star Wars fans, and this has been me, Danny Schofield, and with me has been Ruari Williamson, so yeah.
Hey, the thing everyone's
doing. I'm good. Okay, may the force be with you, Star Wars fans.